I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Today's topic is housing. The question is, what does the market hold? What's the future? Housing, home ownership is a source of wealth creation in our community. Americans' middle class grows in wealth and power by owning a home, the mortgage. But our community, the black community, has been sort of wrenched out of the market in the past generation, it seems. That may be changing. Things may be afoot now to reinvigorate and create new and expanded opportunity for people of color, for urban cities. So today I want to talk about housing, the challenges and opportunities for our community. I'm pleased to have members of my neighborhood. Blong Yang represents me in the 5th Ward of Minneapolis. Blong, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And my neighbor around the corner and across the street, Nicole Knuckles. She's a banker. She's runs the Wells Fargo Diverse Segments and Charity Giving. Nicole, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
So we talk all the time about the question of how institutions and the government and individuals can do better to make better opportunities for our community. Blong, let me start with you. What's the story right now in Fifth Ward, North Minneapolis, where we live?
So a couple of things. I mean, one is we have a vacant housing recycling program. Basically, houses that are run down, dilapidated, or were, you know, in disrepair, probably closer to the foreclosure crisis, but just recovering from that. You know, we were, as a city, I mean, demoing these houses, you know, we were creating vacant lots, we were doing those sorts of things that really didn't allow for the reuse of these houses or recycling these houses. And for the most part, I mean, when I got in office, I mean, we kind of slowed that down quite a bit and just said, you know, can we reuse these houses? Can we figure out how to rehab these houses and get them back into, you know, people who need the houses, basically? And so, you know, the vacant housing recycling program is a program that allows for that. And, you know, the problem we have with that program is just that, in a lot of ways, people who have to have capital can get in. So the folks who are getting into these houses to rehab these houses, they have a lot of money to get in. Mm-hmm. Well, that excludes a certain segment of the population. Mm-hmm. So that's one part of it. And the most recent thing is that, you know, we have up on the north side, I mean, in terms of single family zone housing, I mean, we have upwards of about 400 empty lots. And that doesn't even include county or private, right?
So city-owned lots.
City-owned lots. We have almost 400. And, you know, one of the things that I thought about in terms of, like, figuring that part out is how do we build houses, build new houses on these lots and get these lots into working order? Because if we don't, people dump on them. People do other things on these lots that just is not productive. And so how do we make it productive again? And so the city passed a policy recently that basically addresses that piece. You know, we have a pilot project in the next year that basically has three prongs to it. One prong is basically no income restrictions. If you want to build a brand new house on the north side, we'll give you up to $25,000 to build a brand new house on the north side.
Anybody can get in.
Yeah. No income restrictions. You know, $20,000 for everybody, but $5,000 more for first responders and teachers. Mm-hmm. The second prong is basically continuing what Green Homes North was doing in terms of developer subsidy, you know, upwards of close to about $70,000, if not a little bit more, depending on, you know, how much a house costs to build it and how much it, how much you can get to sell it and that gap in between there. So we're going to continue that piece of it. And then the third piece is really just this community land trust model where we're going to put in $25,000 for, you know, 80% AMI and below to make a house much more affordable for folks who, you know, generally probably couldn't get into a house. And so those are kind of the three prongs that we're, you know, using in terms of, you know, tackling the issues of vacant lots. And hopefully, I mean, we will do that in a much more accelerated manner than we have in the past. In the past, I believe, you know, 8 years or so, we tackled about, you know, upwards of about a little bit over 150 to 175 lots with this one. I mean, we're going to try to see if we can tackle all of the lots that we own up here on the north side.
In a short period of time.
Yes.
How many lots beyond the ones that are owned by the city are there? I mean, the question's important because it seems like we're in a wasteland. Right. Our city, our ward, seems very empty.
Right.
It's not dense, and that's a problem. We need more people in Fifth Ward.
If you count county lots, I would say county lots are probably about 50% of what we own. So, you know, let's say if the city owns 400 empty lots on the north side, I'm guessing the county owns probably about 200 of them, 200 more on top of the 400 that we own. Okay. And then if you can add some private lots to that, I don't think those numbers of private lots are that much higher. But, you know, I mean, these are, you know, what I would call single-family zone lots. I mean, if you include multifamily zone lots and commercial lots, in total, in the city of Minneapolis, I mean, we have upwards of about 1,000 city-owned lots, basically. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What does that mean for the question and the fear of gentrification in our community? A lot of people who left out of the lots are vacant because people either couldn't keep them or were enticed or had to leave. And the question has always been, are we going to displace people who have historic and legacy ties or for whom this has always been an opportunity to be in a starter situation? How do we ensure the cultural diversity and this opportunity and inclusion as we develop a policy to solve the problem of vacant lots and lack of housing?
Sure. You know, I think it's government's role to encourage homeownership in terms of communities of color so that communities of color can get into these homes. And I think, I mean, when we look at, you know, these sorts of situations, I mean, I think we should look at them as opportunities. Mm-hmm. Opportunities for folks who live on the north side to get into these homes, to own these homes, own these nicer homes, and, you know, really, I mean, make or put roots down so that they don't get displaced. And I think, I mean, sometimes, you know, when we look at gentrification, I mean, we see it as like a big problem. And, you know, I'd like to say, I mean, you know, I think in some ways it's happening. I mean, gentrification is happening. I mean, it's just a question of at what rate will it happen and at what rate will it cause people to be displaced. But, you know, the idea is we don't want to displace anybody, at least from my perspective. I mean, I want to uplift the folks who live on the north side because I think they deserve a place to live. And if not the north side, where else? You know, I think that's a big question. And so when you think about that, I mean, you have to think about, you know, how do we get people to get, let's say, their credit in order, get other things in order so that they can own these homes that are, you know, coming up, basically. And I think that's really important for me. I mean, Wells Fargo has a LIFT program that is just amazing. You guys still have some money in there,
yes.
About $2 million, I think. And, yes. You know, there are other different programs. That, I mean, if we stack these things and try to do everything we can to keep people on the north side, I mean, I think it's a plus for all of us.
Nicole, what about the LIFT program? That's a great idea.
Yeah, so LIFT, down payment assistance, up to $7,500. The dollars are allotted to either St. Paul or Minneapolis City proper. So obviously with, you know, the north side fits in perfectly in terms of a location to leverage the dollars. Generally speaking, if you qualify for a first mortgage, you're probably gonna be able to qualify for the LIFT dollars. Of course, you mentioned 80% of area median income. That is one of the restrictions. We do wanna make sure these dollars are being utilized by households that are under 80% of area median income. They need it the most in terms of, you know, putting a financing package together for, say, one of these urban land, you know, filling in these homes on the vacant lots. You're gonna need some help. New construction is a little bit on the more expensive side.
Our country, I think, is based on creating wealth through home ownership. People getting mortgages and people moved to ownership and wealth creation, particularly after World War II with the GI Bill.
Yes.
In some ways, black community benefited, but not as aggressively as other communities did, but it's never too late. And so I'm glad that Realtors are here with us in this conversation. Carmen McAfee and Mike Spicer are with the RE/MAX organization. And Mike, you also are the president of the National Association of Real Estate Realtors, right?
Board chair, yep.
War chair. And so I have always been conscious of the critical role of the business of homeownership. And I celebrate the fact that you all are in the business to make money, but your business is to get people into a living environment that creates an asset for them that grows their opportunity. How does it look to you right now? And I want you to respond from our shared position as African Americans who feel like we got left out a little bit, but we also know we can make it in this arena. What do you think, Mike and Carmen?
I think that we definitely got left out, but it's time to make up that loss. And so NARAB actually is coming in with the $2.5 million program, which is really driving to get African American homeownership up. And we're gonna do that over the next 5 years. I see on a personal level, like just me on the streets, working with individuals, trying to get into home ownership, that if you know the different programs that are out there, kind of like the LIFT that you were just talking about, and there's several other programs, especially in Minneapolis and other areas, that you can make up for that gap, and we're able to get a lot of people into home ownership.
Carmen, give me some stories. What are you finding out as you talk to people who either want to buy a house or sell a house? What are the barriers, and what happens when people are successful?
So many people are not ready to buy because they themselves have already discredited themselves. They believe they aren't able to buy. So until you actually speak with a loan officer or sit down with myself as a realtor, you don't know what your capabilities are. There are people who are out there who make a fairly decent amount of income, and they've never owned a home. So what I think it's personally, I believe a lot of it has to do with the individuals themselves. Mm-hmm. We defeat ourselves. As a community, we think that, or I should say as a whole, people think that renting is the answer to everything. We've passed that down through history, but we as African-American people, we spend a lot of money. We spend $1.3 trillion. So clearly the money is there. We just channel it in the wrong direction. So we have to shift our focus into putting it where it's going to drive our assets versus liabilities.
Okay, so how do we do that? What's it take?
So first you should, again, sit down with the realtor, me, and I'll share the right loan officer for you, fitting your financial needs. Or not everybody will be in programs. Some people have 401ks you can leverage that to put down for a house as well. So you need 2 years tax returns, you need three months of bank statements and a month's worth of W-2. So you do have to work a steady job. You can't, say you're sporadic with employment. You can also have some instances, and disabilities can also, people with disabilities income can also apply for a mortgage. So there's various opportunities for people.
I want to talk about why there is a reluctance sometimes in our community to move towards homeownership. What you said, Carmen, I think, was that a lot of times we create barriers. Some barriers are real, but some are not. And so we have somehow convinced ourselves that we either don't need to or shouldn't or may not be worthy, or that we fear we'll be turned down, so we don't try. So I want to talk about what the mindset is of the Black community. Councilmember Yang, you're in our community, but there's also a growing Latino community, a growing Asian community in the Fifth Ward. And I'm interested in discussing this whole, the concept, the philosophy of equity and homeownership, and how do we change the conversations in our community so that people recognize opportunity, and both individually and through families and through associations, go out and grab the opportunity to build equity in community. Before I do that, Mike and Carmen, tell me your personal stories. How did you get in the business of doing brokers, being real estate sales and producers?
I was lucky enough to be in owning a business when I was younger, and at about 19, I decided that I wanted to get into home ownership, which was pretty young.
What business were you in before?
So in North Minneapolis, my family, they own a barber and beauty shop, and I owned a pager store. Believe it or not, pager and then cellular phones. Okay. So we're dating myself, yeah. But years ago. And then I expanded it and ended up buying a building along West Broadway. And we did music, and it was kind of like an emporium of, you know, music and pagers and phones and things like that. Mm-hmm. But during that time, I said, you know what? I wanted to get into home ownership. I knew that prices were going up at the time. Mm-hmm. And I thought it would be a good investment. I saw where my dad owned his building, mm-hmm. and I saw the value go up. And so I went through a realtor and ended up buying a house. Only stayed there a couple years, and I noticed that the value went up about $60,000. And so at that point, I told myself, I said, I need to get into this business. And I did. It took about 4 or 5 years, but I ended up getting into it. Now I've been a broker for 14 years.
Mm-hmm. So your dad was in business.
Correct.
And so what does legacy mean for you? It's important to me. I'm a second generation entrepreneur. My children are in my business as well. Mm-hmm. And so I'm mindful of the obligation and the opportunity to create a business or a revenue stream that is more than one generation that can grow, hopefully exponential. But what does that mean for you?
To me, it means a lot. You know, my great grandmother, I can look at her mm-hmm. and say that, you know, she owned a business. She was also a beautician.
Where?
Richmond, Indiana.
Okay.
And she drove her beliefs into us, mm-hmm. Whether that be through God, through what she wanted in life. And that instilled into my dad, which he, you know, kind of, we always say he had like a military mindset of growing up that we had to do things a certain way. And so he kind of took on that from her. And it means a lot to me growing up and seeing those things and being able to duplicate them. However, I think I've seen people that maybe didn't come from a background of home ownership to be able to be first generational homeowners. And so I've taken what they've given me to show them, this is what you need to do, and telling my story about what it's done for me. And you know, that catches on with people, and that takes them to the next level as well.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll continue in just a minute. A great conversation. We're going to continue with Blong Yang. He's 5th Ward City Council member, my neighborhood, North Minneapolis. My neighbor from around the corner, Nicole Knuckles, who's a banker with the Wells Fargo organization. And you just heard Mike Spicer and his colleague, Carmen McAfee, members of the REMAX team in North Minneapolis. We'll talk about business creation, wealth creation, home ownership. How do we change and grow our community? Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. The topic is home ownership. Home ownership, to me, is equivalent to the pathway, the gateway to wealth creation. Our community needs to experience expanding opportunity, expanding ability to create wealth, to provide capital for its own development, to create a city that supports our identity and our opportunity. Carmen, Mike's story is great. I want to get your story. How did you come to be in the real estate business?
My story is a little different from Mike's in that I worked in corporate America for 13 years, and actually that's how I got to the Twin Cities. And so in doing that, I was in charge of budgeting and forecasting. And so throughout the cycles of corporate America, there are people who are getting their jobs downsized. So I put the budgets together. And after seeing that over and over again, I decided, you know, I wanted to be in charge of my own destiny. And I also wanted to do something that made a difference to humanity. So I thought about housing and that the impact in our community, because there is a lack of home ownership or people owning homes in the community. And so I came from a background where my parents did own a couple of homes. And then there were entrepreneurs in my background, my family. My dad also had this entrepreneurial spirit, but both my parents worked for the airline, so, and they retired from there. So I got to see the world. I had dreams and visions of doing, you know, things that were entrepreneurial. So that's pretty much how I landed into being a realtor.
So how important is it to have a dream, to have a vision, to have experience, to be exposed to the idea that the world really can belong to you, that you're a co-equal partner in the creation of all of existence? Too often our people see ourselves so limited and so unable to be masters of our own destiny and fate, but you don't have that. You have the knowledge that everything is possible.
Right. So to me, for me, travel did open those doors. I saw things at an early age a lot of people aren't blessed to have, but I have had them. And so with that, that always created to me a world of you can do anything and you can go any place. It wasn't so much that my parents said that, but they showed it. So I think when we have kids or we're cultivating kids, we should always let them be aware that, you know, the world is broader than what you're looking at, and take them places to expand their minds and challenge their thinking. And so with that, to me, like, you can create an unlimited world.
As you speak, I'm thinking about what my parents told me. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, and where I lived on 28th and Brooklyn at 5 or 6 years old, the parents would say, you can go as far as the alley, to the street, down this street, but never cross the street. So my world was my block, my neighborhood. And the difference now, it's just 70 years later, I have come to understand that the entire world is my neighborhood, right, not the other way around. So that speaks to your point of having the exposure. And so, Blong, as our neighborhood diversifies, how do we capitalize on, you know, support and grow this global vision and let it take roots in ways that connect all of the parts of our community to all of the parts of the world in ways that fertilize and grow and strengthen the mosaic, right, of possibility for North Minneapolis and cities like it?
Well, so I'm going to take a step back and just, you know, go with this theme of stories, right?
Sure.
So I grew up in a poor Hmong household. My parents were on public assistance. They'd rented for pretty much most of their lives.
You're born here.
I wasn't born here. I was born in Thailand, came here as a refugee when I was 3. And, you know, for most of my life, I mean, my parents were on AFDC. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we knew renting, we knew public housing for the most part. And, you know, when I went to law school, you know, I finished with law school, got my first job. And I think for me, I mean, just seeing that everybody else, you know, it seemed everybody else, I mean, they owned and they were doing well. And so, you know, on my $35,000 a year legal aid job, the first year after I was done with legal aid, I bought my house. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was probably not that smart in terms of making that much money, but, you know, it was something that I just wanted badly to do, and I figured out everything next. And, you know, so I had owned that home since 2002. And, you know, for myself, I mean, when we look at the different groups of people, you know, whether they're African-American, Hmong, Somali, different groups, I mean, they all have different needs. I mean, it's not the same thing. And so what we're doing sometimes is, as government, sometimes we have a one-size-fits-all type of approach to things, right? And so, you know, if you're Muslim, well, our solution doesn't really match you necessarily. Or, you know, I mean, if our solution is a solution for government, well, our solution doesn't necessarily match African-Americans. And so, I mean, how do we do it differently? And, I mean, that's kind of the question that I am faced with all the time. I mean, you know, you look at what some of the Hmong folks who live in North Minneapolis has done. And, you know, I mean, this is more so maybe stereotype than anything, but, you know, what we have seen is there are longtime homeowners, but there are some homeowners who came after 2008, and essentially they dropped their houses. Their houses were foreclosed upon in the Brooklyn Center, Brooklyn Park area, and they came into North Minneapolis and they cashed out their houses. And when they cashed out their houses, I mean, what they did was they bought their houses for anywhere from maybe $30,000 to $60,000, and that's what they have, but I mean, they don't have any cash to rehab those houses to make them, you know, let's say, I mean, livable to the point where people can say, wow, this is a great house and all that stuff. And so they're stuck in that house and they're stuck, right? And I mean, you know, you see different groups have different problems with housing. And I think that's the part that sometimes we don't act fast enough as government to make it work for people. And so I would say, I mean, in terms of going into the future, I mean, we have to be much more nimble in terms of trying to figure out different groups and what their needs are and fitting policies for the needs of people. And I think that's the part where I can tell you we struggle as government because, you know, we do it a certain way. And it typically is a certain way that fits a certain group of folks, but it doesn't fit everybody. And so we got to do better with that.
Nikki, you're passionate about justice and equity, and you want to bring sort of a personal commitment to a vision of justice and equity to this field, this work of ownership and equity. Talk about that, if you would.
Yeah, I'm going to stick on the quick story. You may be my neighbor now, my second home in North Minneapolis, but Blong and I were neighbors literally across the alley from each other for a long time in Jordan. And that was the first house I ever lived in my whole life. I had moved 35 times before I lived on that corner. I didn't know about money. I always thought when I learned how to read a credit report being a banker, I was like, oh my gosh, this is what rich people know. And through many of my partnerships with NAACP St. Paul in particular, Jeff Martin said to me, Nikki, that's what rich white people know. And so those types of messages that I've heard in my career and even in growing up, I have really translated that into the work I do, whether it's, you know, making a $1.2 million commitment to racial disparity in home ownership, or it's bringing Lyft to the market with my team to help a family get into home ownership. I am blessed enough along the spectrum to be able to bring some of that justice from the inside, working for a large organization. And, you know, I get very excited when my colleagues at work listen to me and they hear me and they hear some of the stories that I bring through my partnerships, through the conversations I have with organizations, with even a family. And I do carry that into my work, and it is a lot of work that we have to do. One of the things that we talk about at NARAB is three generations to build wealth and one generation to lose it. And what does that mean? And how does within home ownership, knowing that that is such a vehicle to create wealth, how do we think about from the credit report and looking at it and understanding it and all of those steps that need to occur for sustainable home ownership to the transfer of that wealth? How are we writing our wills and our trusts, and are we getting the right advice? And those are not things that I understand, and often I talk about how difficult it is. And I do come, because of racism of past and today, I do come with a level of privilege, racial privilege, and getting access to information. And so I regard that. I regard that deeply, and I share that. And I do feel it's my mission in life to do it.
Blong, how do you deal with then, as you were saying, understanding that one size doesn't fit all? How do we shift policy so that the policy is responsive and encouraging to all of the different nodules or the different expressions of community? How do we ensure that those newly arrived families from Somalia or from Thailand or from other communities have systems in place that are responsive to their vision, their desire, and at the same time, not at the exclusion of black people who've been there for 100 years or 20 years or 30 years. So it's not I win, you lose. How do we create a process that all of us can win in?
You know, if I had the answer to that, I mean, I would be reelected easily. That wouldn't be an issue. But, you know, I think that's the thing, is that getting in and really figuring out that there are those problems that are just so hard to get over, basically, to overcome at this point. And, you know, because I don't think government has, within its intention, this idea that we're going to help one group at the exclusion of another. I mean, I think sometimes, you know, we just do one policy that is supposed to fit everybody. And, you know, I mean, if we're going to use the word kindly, I mean, sometimes it just benefits white people. Mm-hmm. And we don't go beyond that because we don't know how to go beyond that. And so that's the part where we're not nimble, we're not fast enough to really figure out how to do it for different groups. I mean, because to me, I mean, a good solution is having 20, 30, 50 different policies for different groups of folks so that it moves well for different groups so that every group benefits. And that's the thing, is that we aren't good enough to do that. I mean, we're good enough to do maybe one, if at all, one, right? Basically, so that's the part that just makes it that much more difficult. And I think, I mean, that's the challenge, is that how do we move, let's say, a big entity like the city of Minneapolis to figure out that piece of it? Because, you know, I mean, Mr. McFarlane, I mean, my thing is just, I mean, as city governments, we haven't really figured out the African-American, you know, issue. I mean, in terms of bringing and lifting African-Americans up, I mean, we can't really do that for everybody else either. I mean, we're not that great at that. And mm-hmm. and I think the intention is there to try and to be better. But sometimes, I mean, it's the intentions are just not good enough. I mean, we got to do better in terms of, like, making it apply and work. And I think that's a part where we as government struggle. You know, I really believe that, you know, people in government want to do good. They will want to try very hard, but sometimes it's just you are stuck at a wall and you just don't know how to get through it, and you're just there.
So, Carmen, where is our part? Carmen and Mike, where is our part? How do we organize our community so that we are focused on the opportunity and so committed to making it happen now? And that the now is an unending now, so it goes on not only with us, but with our children and their children, that we are ferociously engaged in trying to create advantage for ourselves, not to create disadvantage for anybody else, but how do we create fulfillment and empowerment of our families, our community? What do you think, Carmen?
I think education, first of all, we, through NARAB and through individual organizations, roll out plans with churches, since the churches usually are the center of the communities for us. We have different workshops, buyer homeowner workshops, and then there's seller homeowner workshops. Some of these sellers have been in their homes for a very long time, and they want to move on. So we do need that people to move up, as well as new home ownership, to make this community thrive. But so we get our families all involved in education. I think we have to start, unlike other communities, we have to start at a young age talking to our kids about home ownership and credit, and so that it, by the time they get to 21, 22, there's this eagerness there, and they're talking about it with their friends. And you know, in some communities, they combine efforts together and they buy stuff. So education, to me, has to start at the groundwork and then a ground level. And then we talk about it in our churches, our different communities, and not just talk about it, do something about it. Because the Bible says faith without works is dead. So we have to take this, some action plans, and roll it out and show them what the steps are. And that's where the Realtors come through, and that's where Nikki's organization comes to help with different programs. And again, everybody's not in categories of programs. There are people out there making $80,000, $90,000 who never owned a home, and I've helped those kind of people. So we have to talk about it and insist upon it, and show these people. Sometimes you really have to, you know, hold them by the hand and drag them through. So these are, to me, ways of helping our community faster than now is, you know, education and different events we're doing to roll those initiatives out.
Mike, you've got a picture, sort of a mind's eye picture. We're going to put it on the screen because you've got a nice little graphic. But sort of walk us through the mind's eye picture vision of the work, the steps for NARAB, National Association of Real Estate Brokers, to bring into fruition this community.
Absolutely. it's really bringing all of your resources together. So we had an event where we brought in all of the minds around the community, from the Build Wealth Minnesotas to the government, you know, to talk about, hey, what do we need to do to get to the next level to bring homeownership up, especially in the African American community, because it's at the lowest, you know, in Minnesota, and it's not as low as it is here. It's not as low nationally. So what do we got to do to bring those numbers up? Well, you know, what we do is we're doing things like through NARAB with April 29th. We're doing a homeownership event for the community in North Minneapolis, and we're looking at doing that in UROC. So it's right in the middle of North Minneapolis. We're going to train people and show them, you know, how do you get into home ownership. On another level, what I'm doing through REMAX is I started a brokerage in Brooklyn Park. You know, there wasn't a large real estate brokerage in the area, and we've got 25 agents right now, and of those, about 95% are African American. So we're working with them, we're working with the training, we're bringing the numbers up through the Realtors to assist in the community, which is huge.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll come back in a few minutes and wrap up this conversation. I want to talk more about the dream, the vision, and this is a great beginning. I think it's important to put out there a picture that ordinary people can grab, can ingest, and begin to order their lives accordingly. So when we come back, we'll talk about the vision and steps to building the community we want. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guests for this program include Blong Yang. He's the city council member for Fifth Ward, my neighborhood in North Minneapolis. Our neighbor, Nicole Knuckles, and she is Wells Fargo's diverse segments manager and the charitable giving manager. Nicole, thank you for being here again. And Carmen McAfee, Mike Spicer, both with the REMAX organization. They are brokers and realtors, and we thank you both for being here too. Mike Spicer, you are the new chair of National Association of Real Estate Brokers. Tell me more about the organization, number one. And then before we went to break, I was asking you to talk about the vision. What's the work? And in this section, I want to try to take our conversation to a high level where we are imparting to our listeners, our viewers, the probability and the inevitability of phenomenal success in creating wealth in our community, of building a neighborhood and a city, a ward that is vibrant, robust, that is a great place to live, and that fully engages all of its people and all of its assets to create quality of life. But back to the vision. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, well, absolutely. And NARAB, National Association of Real Estate Brokers, is the oldest minority trade in the nation. And it really was a focus for when African Americans couldn't be a realtor, quote unquote, when they weren't allowed to be in the organization. It started up in Tampa, Florida. And so it brought realtors in under the umbrella. I believe it was 1948. So as a local group, we actually just brought it within the last year. And we're focused with, I mean, some brilliant people, more brilliant than myself, which is great, to really focus on African-American homeownership in Minnesota. And during the time, we did a opening doors event, and it was more of a visioning, where we got together with different groups of individuals, and we talked about marketing, policies, events, and education, and how we can train not only the realtors that we're working with, but also bring in people that want to get into homeownership and train them. So that's kind of how we were talking about the event that's going to be coming in North Minneapolis.
Okay, okay. Carmen, the vision, what's the big vision? What do you see in your mind's eye in terms of the vitality and the success of our community?
So I think with different programs with Lyft, with home ownership, home stretch education. I think that we can refocus people with moving back to North Minneapolis. There was also a new construction project that's been started by Thor to bring like modular or smart homes to North Minneapolis. So I believe that we are on the right track into building better communities with people of color.
And so, Nikki, part of the challenge is to know where you are, to use data wisely, properly. And what does history tell us?
Sure.
And how do we use knowledge of statistics to move us forward?
Sure. So sharing, building on, Carmen talked about faith a bit. And I think about faith. I think about access to credit. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean? Are there the right products and programs available to really get people in a good financial situation in home ownership? And I think about the message Dr. Pamela Jolly has given us through the 2 million black home owners in 5 years. And the statistics she shared were from HMDA, Home Mortgage Disclosure Act. And in 2015, 15 million people applied for a mortgage. So those would be mortgage originations. And got to double check my numbers here just to be on track here. And out of those 15 million, 877,000 were African American. And one of the things that was just very compelling to me and her message that she shared, actually just last week at our midwinter conference out in Las Vegas, was we have to help people understand that they can try and to spread the message to try. And if it doesn't work the first time, find the resources. Hopefully you found the resources to begin with. Find the resources that are in the community that can help provide the educational opportunity, then try again, and then try again. And her message that just really sank inside of me was that we have to create these pathways on that path of home ownership for African Americans to feel like they can try.
And so, Blong, does that happen with the program that you talked about when you opened the program? A wonderful new initiative to get people into the some 400 lots that are vacant right now in North Side neighborhoods.
Well, so let me start back by just saying, you know, you look at the folks who live in North Minneapolis, and if they're not living in subsidized housing, typically speaking, they're paying more in rent than they are in their mortgages, basically, if they could get a mortgage. And so, you know, by looking at that, I mean, I just think getting people into home ownership makes a lot of sense. You know, from the city of Minneapolis perspective with regards to this infill housing group, you know, what we're trying to do is trying to figure out how to fill every single one of these lots with houses. And hopefully we can get a lot of folks who get into these houses who are African American, because I mean, that's an important goal for a city as well, where we look at the disparities and we're failing, basically. And so, you know, that's kind of how we have to look at the issue. And I think, I mean, on the city side, I mean, or let me start by saying, NARAB, what you all do in terms of getting folks to think about trying, I mean, that's critically important. But I mean, on our side, I mean, we are doing what we can on the developer side to put competition in place so that prices get driven down, so that, you know, folks can try, and they maybe still have to try, but maybe they don't have to try as hard because it's not so far away from them. And so, I mean, that's the part that is important for me, is that, you know, I think beforehand, I mean, we had a marketplace where, you know, typically speaking, certain developers could only play. And, you know, now with what we're doing, I mean, I think it opens up the doors a little bit to more developers playing. And if we have more competition, that just means that it drives prices down, I hope. And if that works out, then, you know, it makes it much more affordable for the average person to be able to get in. And I think that's really important. You know, you look at these 400 empty lots that are on the north side, and, you know, this year, for the pilot year, I mean, if we can get to about anywhere from 25 to 50 houses, I mean, it will be a success. And then I think it will carry us through to the second, third, fourth, and fifth year and onward. But I mean, we have to be successful this first year. And I think that's the important part, is that the three components, I mean, with regards to, you know, no income restrictions, $20,000 to $25,000, build a brand new house up there. I mean, you know, depending on who gets in there, I mean, there's about, I want to say, $250,000 in there. And so, you know, if you do the numbers or the math on that, you know, anywhere from about 10 to 15 houses can be built that way. But, you know, the bulk of the money is for folks that are doing Green Homes North type homes where there is a subsidy in there to, you know, build a house. And so I think that piece of it is in there. But the other piece is a community land trust model piece where the $25,000 goes to the homes. And that isn't restricted to North Minneapolis. That can be used in Northeast or South as well. But, I mean, just kind of those different types of strategies to get people into housing. I mean, I think that's really important that we figure that part out. And, you know, I think a pilot year really allows us to have trial and error, and I think, you know, it makes us much more efficient our second year and beyond.
Yeah, I was thinking people and property, mm-hmm. and bringing people and property together. And you think about just the property itself, I think, to your point, and the people, and being very intentional about how we're outreaching, how we're engaging, is so critical, and that's where I believe NARAB has such a unique position to really get into the community. And here's the deal, I know this, people that live in North Minneapolis, they want to own in North Minneapolis. And I know that. Same with the East Side. I grew up on the East Side, right? East Siders want to live on the East Side. I know that for a fact. And I think, you know, there's a lot of people that grew up on the North Side that may want to move back to the North Side. And, you know, creating these opportunities and bringing people and property together are so critical, and understanding the barriers that both the property barriers, maybe there's a lot of work that needs to be done to some of these properties, or it's a vacant lot. And then the people, what are some of the barriers people are experiencing to access the dollars to be able to match up with the property? And it is going to be an amazing opportunity in North Minneapolis with this urban infill. But we have to be able to partner with media outlets like yours, like the radio. I mean, we have to be able to really leverage these opportunities, and that's why this conversation is so important, in my opinion, as well.
Well, the key for me, Nikki, is that we create a public conversation where there's a new vocabulary about wealth, and the vocabulary itself, the language we explore and we develop, is a language that is oriented to wealth creation, to home ownership, and to equity. And I think that that's what this is all about from my point of view as a communicator and as a newspaper owner and a broadcaster, as a publisher. I'm always concerned, though, that as often as not, where opportunities exist, our people don't get a chance to mine those opportunities. That's why I'm excited to see that NARAB is being a player here to get more black people in the real estate business. As the opportunity exists, how do we ensure that our people get a chance to participate in the buying and selling in the development of our neighborhood to make money, but also to build wealth? What do you think, Mike? How do we do that?
I think a big part.
Here's the other part.
Okay.
I understood a little while ago that when there is this wrenching of the market, that big corporate developers were descending on North Minneapolis and buying blocks and blocks and blocks of houses, and that, in effect, squeezing out individual entrepreneurial realtors, brokers. Is that true or not?
I mean, there was definitely corporations that were coming in and buying up tons of properties. I'm a listing agent, and I went through that time, and I experienced a lot of houses that I would put on the market, and right away, I mean, within 24 hours, they wouldn't even look at it. They would just put an offer in. Mm-hmm. And I think the awareness is with the realtors being able to talk to the sellers. And it's amazing because Minneapolis is a unique city. Because I've experienced a lot of sellers that come to me and say, hey, I want an owner-occupant that will buy my property. So on the deeper side is, how do we get that same education, that same awareness into the community? And I used to door knock. You know, I haven't done it as much lately, but I would do it and educate people. And I experience our realtors are starting to do that, where we go and say, hey, do you know that this program is available, and getting it out to the people? Because if you don't know about it, you're not going to be able to use it.
There was a period of time when there was a lot of energy of people coming into the realty business, becoming brokers and sellers. Mm-hmm. And then there was the period of time where the market broke, the bubble burst, and a lot of people were feeling like they were being blamed for the housing crisis, that they were bringing people into homeownership who weren't qualified to be homeowners. And so the national economy that President Obama inherited at some level was being blamed on poor black people. And that's the shorthand, that because these black people who couldn't afford and shouldn't have been given mortgages got them, then our entire economy collapsed. Well, of course we know that was super crazy, not true. And it was a strategy to walk away from the massive abuse of consumers by big money interests. But the consequence of that was a chilling effect on black people going into the mortgage business. Is that correct or not? Does that sound right to you? Am I describing what I thought I saw properly or not?
No, I think you're describing it right on. And I think it's unfortunate because in our community, I feel like if you're blamed for something, mm-hmm. it might keep you away from wanting to do it later. Mm-hmm. You know, and so if you're thinking, okay, it was my fault that this happened, even though it's not true, what will that do to you when you are, when the opportunities are there, how will you approach it?
And it's not so much blaming you, the individual, it's blaming black people,
right,
the whole culture, mm-hmm. as the fault for the failure of the entire national and therefore global economy. That's a lot of weight to put on people who had been historically damaged, you know, marginalized and exploited by big money interests. And to say that now you're the reason for the failure is horrific, I think. So how do we get past that? How do we know that hype is hype, no matter where it comes from, and that we simply cannot succumb to the impulse to run and hide? That instead of running from this, we got to run into it, right? And we got to attack this market and grow the market and build it. What do you think?
I think education. And I think we need to take it on ourselves in a sense. I've noticed where myself and a lot of other people are using social media even, mm-hmm. saying, hey, this is what I'm doing. This is the people I was able to assist. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a quick story, not a long one, just of when I had my pager and phone store. I was the very first African-American on West Broadway to sell pagers and phones. Mm-hmm. Well, within a year, there was four or five companies that opened, and then 10 companies. Mm-hmm. And I think that in the community, we catch on by seeing what other people are doing. Mm-hmm. And so if we're saying, hey, I just bought a home, other people are going to catch on to that, and it makes them want to learn and say, oh, I can do it too, mm-hmm. you know? And so that, it's the education.
We're down to the last minute. I want to give you each a chance to sort of leave a parting thought. I want to thank you, though, for what you're doing. Councilmember Blong Gang, thank you, Nikki, for what you're doing with Wells Fargo. And thank you, Carmen McAfee and Mike Spicer, for the work you do with RE/MAX, helping individuals find futures at work. And thank you all for the National Association of Real Estate Brokers. But Blong, start with you. You know, what's the message for the moment for our community?
So for myself, I mean, as a policymaker, I mean, I want to hit home runs all the time. But, you know, I know that, you know, for myself, I don't hit home runs just by myself. I think, you know, it requires, you know, folks like Nikki, Mike, Carmen, everybody else to contribute to make it work. And, you know, I think, I mean, our goal really is to get more African Americans into home ownership, because we look at the disparities and it is awful. And we want to be better as a city, and we have to be better as a city. And so that's the important part, is that, I mean, these 400 lots, I mean, I think at the end of the day, I mean, the success is really going to be measured by the diversity of mm-hmm. homeowners that get into these houses. It won't be by filling up every single one of these lots and, you know, they're all, you know, white homeowners. I mean, I just think that's just kind of the reality. And, you know, can we say it loudly? Can we do, not necessarily, but I mean, I think that's just the reality. We want that. I mean, you know, we want these gaps to, you know, be lessened, because, you know, at the end of the day, I mean, we are being measured on a national scale, and mm-hmm. we want to see successes.
That's right. Nikki?
You know, our industry has to mirror the community, and today it doesn't. And I appreciate the conversation here. In terms of the demographics nationally and even here in the Twin Cities, the industry as a whole, we do not have enough African Americans that are in the business. And so whether it is a banker or a loan originator or a real estate agent, it is an opportunity to have a very good living, fulfilling living, And right now, we have a major gap, and I think that contributes to the overall gap in homeownership for the African-American community.
And Mike, and then Carmen. Carmen, you get the last word. Mike, go ahead.
I want to thank you. I think we need more vehicles like yours to get the word out there. You know, National Association of Real Estate Brokers is to create equity in housing. That's one of my dreams. And I think to do that, you know, it's just about getting awareness to the people. And so having vehicles like yours, we need to do more of it and get it out there.
Thank you. Carmen, last word.
Again, thank you, Al, for this conversation. But I would like to say to the viewers, if you are in the position of thinking of home ownership, now's the time. Average sales price is going up. It's the time to seize the opportunity. No matter what the economy was before, we still rise. As Maya Angelou said, we still rise. I know it said I rise, but we still rise. So take the time, take the opportunity, seize the moment, because the time is now.
That says it all. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for listening. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. See you next time. Thank you, guys. Yeah,
thank you.
Good.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Cause this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we gotta give it life.